Hello, space fans, and welcome to another edition of Space Fan News. This week, an update on that gas cloud that I've reported on in the past that was swirling around Sagittarius A star, which is the name given the supermassive black hole at the center of the Milky Way galaxy. And the gas cloud didn't do what astronomers predicted. And new research from the Hubble Space Telescope shows that the universe is accelerating faster than expected. Okay, this first story is a follow-up to one we've been reporting on here at Space Fan News World Headquarters in SFN 81 and 104. And I told you about this very peculiar object that astronomers have been tracing at the center of our galaxy that they believed was a gas cloud about to be devoured by the supermassive black hole lying in wait there. If you want to see those episodes to refresh yourself on the story, click on the little eye icon in the upper left of the video. I put links there for you to follow along if you're interested. Okay, but for those too lazy to click, here's the backstory. For years, astronomers have been puzzled by a bizarre object in the center of the Milky Way that was believed to be a hydrogen gas cloud headed toward our galaxy's 4 million solar mass black hole. And the last time we left this story, back in 2013, we learned that the cloud, which astronomers started calling G2, was getting close to the black hole, and falling in was imminent. So they watched the trajectory of the cloud, and well, guess what? It didn't fall in as predicted. So astronomers had figured that if G2 was a hydrogen cloud as they originally thought, then it could have been torn apart by the black hole, and that the resulting celestial fireworks would have dramatically changed both the state of the black hole and given astronomers a good opportunity to see what happens when stuff falls into one. But as they watched and waited on the trajectory of the cloud, they saw that G2 actually survived and continued happily on its orbit. A simple gas cloud would not have done that. This is from astronomers from UCLA. So G2 was basically unaffected by the black hole. There were no fireworks. They did see this, though. A little disappointing, to be sure. So what happened? If G2 is not a gas cloud falling into a black hole, then what's going on out there? Well, a team led by Dr. Andrea Ghez, professor of physics and astronomy in the UCLA College, determined that G2 is most likely a pair of binary stars that had been orbiting the black hole in tandem and merged together into an extremely large star, cloaked in gas and dust, putting out a false trail for astronomers. Dr. Ghez, who studies thousands of stars in the neighborhood of the supermassive black hole, said G2 appears to be just one of an emerging class of stars near the black hole that are created because the black hole's powerful gravity drives binary stars to merge into one. She also noted that in our galaxy, massive stars primarily come in pairs. She says the star suffered an abrasion to its outer layer as it went by, but otherwise it's going to be fine. Astronomers from the UCLA Galactic Center Group said that when two stars near the black hole merge into one, the star expands for more than 1 million years before it settles back down. They say that this may be happening more than we thought. The stars at the center of the galaxy are massive and mostly binaries. It's possible that many of the stars we've been watching and not understanding may be the end product of mergers that are calm now. This thing has fascinated many astronomers in recent years, particularly during the year that was leading up to its approach to the black hole when I last told you about this in SFN 104. So now G2 is undergoing something that they're calling a spaghettification, really fancy scientific term here, which is a common phenomenon near black holes in which large objects become elongated. And at the same time, the gas at G2's surface is being heated by the stars around it, creating an enormous cloud of gas and dust that has shrouded most of this massive star. Astronomers are now using this object to learn more about black hole accretion physics. It isn't often you get a front row seat to a hungry feeding black hole. Next, astronomers using the Hubble Space Telescope have made some of the most accurate measurements yet of the expansion of the universe and found that, hey, guess what? The universe is accelerating faster than we thought. Now, I've often said in these videos, and I've told you many times, that astronomers have long known that the universe was expanding, but it came as a complete surprise to find that not only was that happening, but the universe was accelerating as it did so. This totally unexpected result led to the idea of dark energy, that there must be some force associated with this acceleration. And that dark energy was what they were calling the thing responsible for this force. So after the discovery that the universe was accelerating, astronomers quickly started looking at the early universe using Hubble, Planck, and WMAP to get an idea just how fast this acceleration occurred early in our universe's history. But this week, members of that same team that discovered the acceleration of the universe, namely Adam Riese and others, have measured the distances to stars in 19 galaxies more accurately than ever before, and they found that the universe is currently expanding faster than the rate derived from those earlier measurements of the universe shortly after the Big Bang from Planck and WMAP. In fact, they found that the universe is expanding between 5 and 9% faster than previously calculated. So this meant that there is a clear discrepancy. So this surprise in a series of surprises about the expansion of the universe means that there must be something else very strange going on, either with dark energy or dark matter, which is what I think, or something else, a new thing I've just heard about they're calling dark radiation. Okay, I know, a new term. Dark radiation is the dark energy, dark matter equivalent to electromagnetic radiation. In the same way that EM radiation describes how subatomic particles like electrons, protons, and neutrons interact, dark radiation is supposed to describe how dark particles, whatever they are, interact. Now, while no one is sure if such a dark radiation exists, it could account for the discrepancy found in these new measurements of the Hubble constant. Now, personally, I've never heard of dark radiation, and I wouldn't argue much with you if you wanted to say astronomers were just making this up to explain some observations. It does seem kind of convenient. But still, the Higgs boson started out this way, and it turned out to be right, so the standard model is working, and I'm willing to see how this plays out. Alright, back to the Hubble constant, called H0 by people who use it every day, also the Hubble parameter, and it's the number used to quantify how fast the universe is expanding. And it is a constant in space, but not in time, so the subscript naught, or zero, means the value of the constant today. It may increase or decrease over different time intervals. And, in an interesting side note, measuring the Hubble constant was one of the original science goals of the Hubble Space Telescope. It was one of the reasons and one of the justifications they gave for building it in the first place. And for over 25 years, it has been refining that measurement. And this week's announcement marks the latest result. This refined determination of the Hubble constant announced yesterday was made possible by making precise measurements of the distances to both nearby and faraway galaxies using Hubble, and gives us the best measurement yet of the nearby universe expansion rate. So according to the press release as I read it, comparing the universe's expansion rate as calculated by WMAP and Planck, which were measurements for the time right after the Big Bang, and Hubble, which were measurements for our modern universe, is like building a bridge where you start at two ends and you expect to meet in the middle if all of your drawings are right and your measurements are right. But now, the ends are not quite meeting in the middle, and astronomers want to know why. So the team is continuing to use Hubble with the aim of reducing the uncertainty in the Hubble constant even further, their goal being to reach an uncertainty of just 1%. Well, that's it for this week, Space Fans. Thanks to all my Patreon patrons for supporting SFN, and thank you all for watching. And as always, keep looking up. Okay, I want to remind you guys, Deep Astronomy has an app now that you can download on your iPhone and your Android device. It's available on both the App Store, the Apple App Store, and the Google Play Store. So please download it. You get all of the content that we're producing there, from Hangouts to Space Fan News to podcasts, all of it there. So please download it and let me know what you think.